was on one of the Munster raids that had happened. Been one of those trips you dream about. Hardly any opposition over the target. Just a few searchlights and very little flak. And that night at Munster, I saw more fires than I've ever seen before. We dropped our bombs right on the target area and then made a circuit of the town to see what was going on before the pilot set course for home. As second pilot, I was in the Astrodome keeping a lookout all round. And suddenly, over the middle of the Zeta Z, I saw an enemy machine coming in from the port. Called up to the pilot to tell him that our intercom had gone fat. A few seconds later, before anything could be done about it, there was a slamming alongside us and chunks of red-hot shrapnel were shooting about all over the place. The squadron leader put the nose straight down to try and dive clear. That time we didn't know that the rear gunner had got the attacking plane, a Messerschmitt 110, because the intercom was still out of action and we couldn't talk to the rear turret. We'd been pretty badly damaged in the attack. The starboard engine had been hit and the hydraulic system had been put out of action, with the result that the undercarriage fell half down, which meant, of course, that it would be useless for landing unless we got it right down. The bomb doors fell open and the wireless set wasn't working, and the front gunner was wounded in the foot. And worst of all, a fire was burning up through the upper surface of the starboard wing, where a petrol feed pipe had been split open. We all thought that we'd have to bail out, so we put on our parachutes. Some of us got going with a fire extinguisher and burst a hole in the side of the fuselage so that we could get out the wing. But the fire was too far out along the wing for that to be of any good. Then we tried throwing coffee from the flasks onto it, but that didn't work either. It might have damped the fabric around the fire, but it didn't put it out. By this time, we had reached the Dutch coast and were flying along parallel to it, waiting to see how the fire was going to develop. Squadron leader said, "What's it look like to you?" I told him the fire didn't seem to be gaining at all and seemed to be quite steady. He said, "Well, I think we'd prefer a night in a dinghy to ending up in a German prison camp." And with that, he turned out seawards and headed for England. I had a good look at the fire and I thought there was a decent chance of reaching it by getting out through the Astrodome and down the side of the fuselage and out onto the wing. Joe, the navigator, said he thought it was crazy. There was a rope there that's usually tied to the dinghy to stop it drifting away if you land on the water. We tied that around the chest and I climbed out through the Astrodome and sat on top. I still had my parachute on. I wanted to take it off because I thought it'd get in the way. They wouldn't let me. I sat on the edge of the Astrodome for a bit with my legs inside, sort of working out how I was going to do it. I reached out with one foot and kicked a hole in the fabric so that I could get my foot into the framework of the plane. Then I punched another hole through the fabric in front of me to get a handhold. After that, made some more holes and went down the side of the fuselage onto the wing. Joe was holding onto the rope so that I wouldn't drop straight off. I went out about 3 or 4 feet along the wing, and then the fire was burning up through the wing, rather like a big gas jet, blowing back past my shoulder. I had one hand to work with because I was holding on to the cockpit cover with the other. I never realized how bulky a cockpit cover could be. The wind kept catching it and several times nearly blew it away, and me with it. I kept bunching it up under my arm, and then it'd blow out again. All the time, of course, I was lying as flat as I could on the wing. But I couldn't get right down flat because of the parachute on my chest. The wind kept lifting me off the wing. Once it slapped me right back against the fuselage, but I managed to get hold again and get back. The slipstream from the engine made things worse. It was like being in a terrific gale, but worse than anything I've known before. Can't explain it, but there was no real sense of danger out there. It was just a matter of doing one thing after another, and that's about all there was to it. I tried stuffing the cockpit cover down through the hole on the wing onto the pipe where the fire was. But as soon as I took my hand away, the draft just blew it straight out, and finally it blew away altogether. The rear gunner told me afterwards that he saw it go sailing past his turret. I couldn't hold on any longer, and after that there was nothing to do but to get back again. I worked my way along the wing and managed to haul myself up onto the top of the fuselage and got sitting on the edge of the Astrodome again. Joe kept the dinghy rope taut all the time, and that helped. And by the time I got back, I was absolutely done in. I got my left leg into the Astro hatch and just sat there looking at my right foot. I couldn't move it. And Joe reached out and pulled it in for me. After that, I flopped down inside onto the bed and stayed there. In order to lighten the aircraft, we threw out just about everything movable, other than valuable things like the bomb sight and sextant. And though the damaged engine was only developing about a third of its power, we managed to maintain height about 5,000 feet, I suppose, for a long time, and just kept on going. Joe was keeping a plot the whole time. He'd sort of nip back in the middle of things and work out a new position, and then go back and help with throwing out some more stuff. The wireless operator got the set going again, and the rear gunner stuck to his turret the whole of the time, even though he couldn't hear us or see what we were doing. It took us an hour and a half to cross from the Dutch coast to the English coast. The front gunner had jettisoned his guns when he was wounded because his turret had been knocked out and wasn't any use at all. He helped fix some other things, and then, seeing that there was no more to do, we just sat there and looked at the fire and wondered what was going to happen next. Then, just when we were within reach of the English coast, the fire on the wing suddenly blazed up again. There was a pool of petrol on the lower surface of the wing, and this caught fire. I remember thinking to myself, well, this is pretty hard after having got this far. However, after this final flare-up, the fire died out altogether, much to our relief, I can tell you. The trouble now was to get down. We pumped the wheels down with the emergency gear, and the pilot decided that instead of going to our own base, he'd try to land at another aerodrome nearby, which had a far greater landing space. As we circled before landing, he called up control and said, "We've been badly shot up. I hope we don't make too much of a mess of your flare path when we're landing." And he put the aircraft down beautifully. But as we had no brakes, we finally ran into a barbed wire entanglement on the end of the drone. Fortunately, nobody was hurt, though, and that was the end of the trip.